ओम विश्वम दर्पण दृश्यमान नगरी तुल्य निजांतर्गतम पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिर्वोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यस्साक्षात् कुरुते प्रबोध समये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्री गुरुमूर्तये नमः श्री दक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिमाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यपि महायोगी वयस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये। ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ॐ वर्स नंबर 18। सवेत्ति वेद्यं तत्सर्वं नान्यस्तस्यास्ति वेदिता विदिता विदिताभ्यां तत् पृथग्बोधस्वरूपकम्। वेरियस फीचर्स ऑफ ब्रह्मन बेस्ड ऑन तैत्तिरीय उपनिषद इज बीइंग डिस्कस्ड हियर एंड वी हैव कंप्लीटेड टू इंपॉर्टेंट फीचर्स दैट इज ब्रह्मन इज पंचकोश गुहा विलक्षण बट ब्रह्मन इज डिस्टिंक्ट फ्रॉम दिस पंचकोशास फाइव शीट्स अन्नमय आदि अन्नमय प्राणमय मनोमय विज्ञानमय आनंदमय एक्सेट्रा एंड द सेकेंड टॉपिक ऑल्सो वी कंप्लीटेड एंड दैट इज पंचकोश गुहा निहितत्व। ब्रह्मन इज द वेरी विटनेस एंड वेल इट इज देयर इट रिसाइड्स इन द पंचकोशास बीइंग विटनेस सी इट एग्जिस्ट एज ए साक्षी। Well, then the question is, if it is a sakshi, well, illumining panchakoshas, how can't I experience it? Vidyarana says, you can't experience the Brahman as an object. That Brahman is you. So the third topic, Brahman is the very Atma, that is you, that is under discussion. From verse number 13 to 27, this is very important topic, and that is Brahman is, well, resides in panchakoshas as a sakshi, but that sakshi is myself. And therefore, there is no question of experiencing the Brahman. So that Brahman, Paramatma alone, well, exists in the form of a Jivatma behind Panchakoshas. As a Sakshi, you can say, as a Jivatma also you say, there is no entity called Jivatma. So you are not to worry. In case, even if I use a word, well, it exists as a Jiva. Oh, Swamiji, you said it exists as a Sakshi. Now you say it exists as a Jiva. Jiva is not Sakshi. Jiva is Sakshi. Jiva is Sakshi. There is no entity called Jiva. Other than it is in the realm of ignorance. It's a purely notional thing. Jiva is a purely pure notion. It only exists in the field of ignorance. There is no Jiva as such. Anyway, so even if I say it exists as a Jiva in Panchakosha, it exists as a witness, it is the same thing. So, this is discussed from verse number 13 to 27. We have completed verse number 17 and we have to enter verse number 18 and which we read just read. So Brahman being well Sakshi Chaitanyam, that is I, it does not require a separate experience to prove that Brahmatma basically. Everything other than myself requires a experience to prove the existence. Well, but I don't require any proof to experience myself, to prove my existence, etc. And so, it is ever experienced consciousness. Let's now see, let's see this verse number 18. This verse actually is a quotation from Shvetashvatara Upanishad, third chapter and verse number 19. And this is the first line. And second line of this verse is from Keno Upanishad, first chapter, fourth mantra. सो फर्स्ट लाइन इज व्हाट सवेद्यम तत्सर्व वेत्ति सह मीन्स आत्मा आत्मा वेत्ति नोज एक्सपीरियंसेस ऑब्जेक्टिफाइज व्हाट वेद्यम विच इज ऑब्जेक्टिफाइबल विच इज नोएबल विच इज एक्सपीरियंसिएबल एक्सेट्रा तत्सर्व सो आत्मा ऑब्जेक्टिफाइज एवरीथिंग विच इज ऑब्जेक्टिफाइबल And it includes mind and sense organs and everything, including every thought is experienced by you. Every thought is basically objectified by you, known by you. So mind, sense organs, body and the entire world, tat sarvam, vedyam tat sarvam. So that is how this entire world, which is nothing but an anatma, including the five sheets, all are objectified. So whole world is illumined by Atma. Atma illumines everything. Tasya na vedita asti. So tasya, of that Atma, there is no other vedita, there is no other knower, there is no other experiencer, actually. There is no other one which objectifies the Atma. So Atma objectifies everything, that is called an Atma. But then Atma itself, maybe require another objectifier or experiencer. Well, that is not possible. Tasya anya vedita nasti. Other Atma which objectifies this Atma can't be there. Otherwise you will ask me for that Atma also, who is experiencer? How will you know that Atma is there, second Atma? Then we have to bring third Atma, which experiences or objectifies the second Atma. Second Atma objectifies first Atma. Then you will say, what about the third one? That's called anavastha. If you remember in the chapter 1, we discussed this dosha. Well, so you should not go ahead. Identifying dosha, don't go ahead in that line of thinking. That's all it means. So it is anavastha. So then better say that the first Atma itself, which experiences everything, which objectifies everything, need not be objectified. Because its nature is like that. Without objectifying it, it is revealing itself. No object without experience reveals itself. No object without getting contacted by the consciousness can reveal itself. Well, the consciousness, well, definitely must be without objectifying, it must be revealing. And therefore, it is self-revealing consciousness. In fact, there is another mantra which is very apt from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. And that is yas sakshat aparokshat brahma. Well, Atma is, well, sakshat aparoksham. Aparoksham which does not require any means of knowledge to be revealed. And therefore means it is self-revealing. Aparoksham, which is ever-evident, brahma. Okay, this is Shrita Shrita Upanishad. First line of the verse. Second line is what? Tat vidita avidita bhyam prathak. We have seen that. This should be familiar to you. We have seen in Keno Upanishad that Atma is different from Vidita Avidita Bhyam Prathak. Vidita Avidita Bhyam, it's the fifth case. And Prathak, Prathak always governs, Prathak, Anyat, all governs fifth case. So that Atma is different from Viditam, means known, and Aviditam, unknown. Atma is distinct from known and unknown category. We may wonder, everything is basically, you know, entire world will be either known or it will be unknown. Only two categories are there. Then they say it is a third category. Atma is distinct from known object or unknown object. So, well, definitely, basically this Atma must be what? Because if you say object of experience, then you will have to put I in either of these two categories. But so, well, if you say it is distinct from unknown and unknown, then it is no more object. That's all it means. Atma is no more an object. If it is distinct from known and unknown, means it is no more an object. Because if you brand it as an object, you will have to put either known or unknown. And therefore, it indicates Atma is very subject. And therefore, every unknown thing will be a future object. Every known thing is a present object. Atma is very distinct from that. That consciousness is distinct from. So here it says Pruthak. Pruthak means distinct. Tat means that Brahman, that Atma is consciousness, is different from known and unknown. And what is this nature? Why do you have to say like this? Because it doesn't require any proof. It doesn't require any proof for knowing. And therefore, it's bodha swarupakam, it is nature of consciousness. All known and unknown are jadam. And definitely that is how object means jadam. And therefore, well, definitely it will be in the category of known and unknown. Atma is very knowledge, you can say that way. Atma is very knowledge by which a object is either known up today or it will be known tomorrow. Unknown means knowable. We have to put like this. Aviditam means unknown. Unknown means it is knowable. Knowable when? Future. Today it is unknown. Tomorrow it will be knowable. And so it will be knowable or it is known because of what? Because of knowledge. That is subject. That is Atma. So Atma is because Chaitanyam. It is distinct from both. Vidita avidita abhyam prathak. Now verse number 19.
Bodhepyanubhavo yasya न कथं च न जायते तं कथं बोधयेत् शास्त्रं लोष्टं नरसमाकृतिं.
Here Vidyaranya says, well, I have taken so much struggle to show, you know, sir, since many days it is going on, that Brahman doesn't require any experience and it is ever evident and self-revealing and self-illuminating, all continuously talking about this only. So much struggle. Vidyaranya, you know, because of so many verses he has formed for that and giving references from the Upanishad, so many Upanishad. So he is struggling to show that Brahman, the Atma, is ever evident to the people. So, well, you have not to work for experiencing Brahman. But work for what then? Then why should I study? Now I have not to work anything. And I am fulfilled. Brahman means it is limitless. And Purna. So, well, I am a fulfilled person. Then I don't want to work. And you are telling now you don't work for it, for experiencing Brahman, because what you are experiencing is Brahman at all. Is Brahman alone. And well, so okay. Then why to study at all? Why should I sit at 9:15 and, you know, in the class? Well, you have to work for something else. Yeah. Because you are not able to claim. You don't have that self-confidence to claim that I am Brahman. Are you able to tell? Your words itself reveal that you are feeling. I mean, so you are ready to tell very confidently you are Jiva. That shows something is to be negated. Something is to be negated. Ultimately, even it is self-revealing, still it requires some negation, because of which you are telling you are an individual or a Jiva. So negate that part. For that you have to work. So work for negating, you know, this superimposed attributes on Brahman, which is self-revealing, that is attributes of body, mind, sense complex. You have to work for it to negate that. You have to understand, negation means you have to ascertain that it is mithya. Once you ascertain it is mithya, it is negation. You have not to negate physically or something, not in the mind, even mind, you have not to negate in the mind. I am not body. No, you need not do all this. Just understand what is mithya. Once you ascertain it is mithya, it is negation. Any mithya thing is negated automatically from your mind. Anyway, so you have to work for negation. You have to work for renouncing something rather than gaining something. You are already gained, and that gain is a gain without any loss. It's a big gain, really speaking. Any gain involves a loss. And second thing, any gain will be lost. That's also there. Any gain involves a loss. Like you gain money, definitely your precious life goes away in that. Precious years of life goes away. You have to sacrifice your maybe a family life also in earning. People at the home, family members are enjoying, you know, and you are working somewhere and you may be on the road. Who knows? And therefore, basically, any gain involves a loss. You have to put efforts, you have to sacrifice your health. That's how people say wealth comes at the cost of health. That is how it is. So anyway, any gain involves loss. And what is gained also will be lost. Sarve sanyogaha vyogantaha. This is a law. So you are Gain means you are associated with the money and fame, name and fame and everything. One day that also goes away. Anyway, but the Brahman is a gain. Gain of Brahman is a gain without loss. How? Well, because it is already gained. So the knowing itself is a gain. Anyway, today morning itself we discussed that it is in Brahmanandvalli. Brahmavid apnoti param. The knower of Brahman gains Brahman. And there was a big discussion in Bhashyam. What is this apnoti? Gain always involves of an object which is limited in time and place. Right? Whatever you gain, definitely it is involved, the time is involved, place is involved, and therefore it is automatically limited. Limited in time, limited in place, any object. Gain means gain of an object. And it will be, it always involves this. And you said Brahman is gain. Then Brahman, on the other hand, you said Brahman is sarvavyapi. Sarvagatam, Bhashyakara says. Sarvagatam and Jivatma Swarupam. And it is all pervasive, and it is basically a nature of consciousness. It is the nature of a Jiva. Then where is the question of gaining Brahman? And you shamelessly write apnoti. Brahmavit param apnoti. This knower of Brahman gains limitlessness. This gain is in terms of knowing. Bhashyakara explained atmavare drishtavyah. So well, seeing itself is a gain. Like knowing the tenth man, knowing that I am a tenth man is a gain of a tenth man. The person who has as though lost tenth man, now because of the aptavakyam, because of the person, the person who is a traveler, who is going past, who is a passerby, he tells, well, you are tenth man. So well, he gains as though tenth man. He lost as though tenth man, now gain as though tenth man. That's how it is. And that gain is in terms of knowing that I am tenth man. That's all it is. And so that is how, basically, this is a gain of a already gained, in which does not involve any loss. Anyway, so this Brahma, Anubhava, etc., well, don't work for that. In fact, you have to renounce something. That is how we always say, Tyagena eke amritattvam anashuhu, Tyagena. By renouncing, you become limitless. In fact, you gain and then gain and gain and gain and gain, one day you become limitless. No. Just give it up. Just give up. Once you give up, you become limitless. That's an amazing thing, right? You give up, you become limitless. Generally, when you start giving up, you become empty one day. You become shunyam. But here it says by giving up, you become limitless because you are already limitless. And because with the superimposed attributes, you feel limitation. So give up those attributes which are mithya. Understanding them in terms of reality, body, etc., they are mithya things. And while they are really not, they don't touch me. I am the Satyam, Adhishthanam of all these things. I am Asangam, etc., etc. And they have a borrowed existence, etc. Anyway, so understanding the mithya, if this is a way, we have to renounce it. So Brahma Anubhava is not lacking to anyone. But even after telling so much of thing, even student says, well, I have heard very nice things since 3-4 talks, well, very beautiful. I have heard Vedantic teaching, but please, before you come, you know, finish this topic, give me a method for experiencing Brahman. Oh, Vidyaranya says, well, oh dear student, you are embodiment of a clay. You are embodiment of a clay. Says, bodhepi anubhava na jayate. Bodhe, bodha vishaye, chaitanya vishaye, atma vishaye. With respect to this ever-experiencing, ever-revealing, ever-illumining consciousness, anubhava na jayate, suppose a person does not understand this consciousness, does not get wisdom. Here anubhava means, we generally, anubhava means experience. But here anubhava means a wisdom, knowledge, etc. So even after, with respect to such self-revealing consciousness, suppose a person does not understand this consciousness of Brahman, and what is all the time experience actually, and he says, well, I don't experience Brahman right now. Well, in that case, I don't know. He says, I don't know how to teach this person. I am giving up because I don't know how to teach this person. Well, I'm not blaming him. I am surrendering actually that I have used all the methods that are, well, that those were with me in my pocket. Now, tam katham shastram bodhayet, tam katham shastram bodhayet. To such a student, who can teach? And katham means in which manner what is the method to employ to teach such a person? Why? Because it is loshtam sama narasamakritim. He is nothing but a clay. Narasamakritim. He is nothing but a clay in the form of hands, legs, face, and you know, well-shaped clay. And therefore, to such a person, no one can teach. Because one misses Brahman at any time. You cannot miss Brahman, but he misses all the time. And that's how we are waiting for a Brahman experience. This shloka actually is borrowed from Nishkarma Siddhi of Sureshwaracharyaji. And Sureshwaracharyaji was a direct disciple, primary disciple of Shankaracharyaji, the first Shankaracharya of a Shringeri Pitha. And he has written a very beautiful work called Nishkarma Siddhi. Nishkarma means moksha, etc. And how, well, moksha siddhi, etc. On that, well, he has written a beautiful, very big book. It's a Prakaran Grantha, like Panchadashi. Vidyaranya also was a Shankaracharya of a Shringeri, but he came much later. Whereas Sureshwaracharya was a direct disciple of a Shankaracharya, and he has actually this verse is there in Nishkarma Siddhi. Vidyaranya has bodily lifted that verse and he is quoting here. And I will tell you in Nishkarma Siddhi, the third chapter, 38th verse is this verse only. Anyway. So it seems all the acharyas are facing this problem with such as students who will definitely at the end of the teaching will say, well, everything is fine. I understood I am Brahman, but I want to experience Brahman. Anyway, but I am fortunate. I feel I am fortunate. Nobody would ask me this question. Anyway, let's go to verse number 20.
वेत्युक्तिहि लज्जायै केवलं यथा न मुद्यते मया बोधः बोधव्य इति तादृशी.
Vidyaranya clarifies a little further. Well, person can't say that I have not experienced consciousness, because consciousness is very nature, is ever experienced as I, the conscious being. You may say, well, instead of using, like, I am a conscious being, you say I am a living being. Okay. If you are a living being, means you are a sentient being. And sentience means a consciousness. And therefore, definitely, it amounts. I am a living being will amount to ultimately I am a conscious being. Anyway, so bodhaha namaya buddhyate. This is a quotation actually. Bodhaha na maya buddhyate iti, etc. So that is a quotation. Vidyaranya criticizes this thing. The person says, bodhaha, chaitanyam, atma. So consciousness is not yet experienced. Na maya buddhyate means by me. Buddhyate means not experienced. Na maya buddhyate means not experienced by me. Consciousness is not yet experienced by me. Well, somebody says like that. This is a quotation of a student. Well, he says what? Further he says also, that student, champion. He says, maya bodhavyaha. And well, I am waiting for the experience of consciousness or Brahman. Well, some people feel that, you know, in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, etc., I will experience that. What I have learned, I will experience in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So, he wants to experience consciousness or Brahman. Iti tadrishi, such a thinking process, it is contradictory, he says. It is a contradictory, and he gives an example here. He says, jihva me asti nava iti uktihi. This statement of a one person who says, well, do I have a tongue or not? Very statement actually comes out because of tongue, right? Language is possible only because of tongue. In fact, that is how in English they call synonym for language is a tongue. Anyway, because without tongue you can't speak. And therefore that person is speaking. What does he speak? Well, do I have a tongue or not? That's a contradictory, self-contradictory thing. सो जिह्वा में अस्थि न वा एक्सेट्रा इति उक्ति ही सच ए स्टेटमेंट कमिंग फ्रॉम ए पर्सन इज अ शेम फॉर थिंकिंग पर्सन तथा इन द सेम मैनर सो वेन एवर एग्जाम्पल कम्स वेदर दे राइट यथा और नॉट यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड यथा मीन्स येन प्रकारेण जस्ट एज लाइक दैट तथा तेन प्रकारेण इन द सेम वे एक्चुअली आई हैव नॉट एक्सपीरियंस्ड कॉन्शियसनेस इज ए कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन A conscious being speaks like that, right? Conscious being speaks that I have not experienced consciousness means what? Actually, that's a self-contradiction. So other student says, well, I don't say that. When that student was saying that I want to experience consciousness, well, the other student gets up in a class and he says, well, I don't say that. I admit that I experience consciousness all the time. But my question is, I want to experience Brahman. I am experiencing consciousness. That's all right. But I want to experience Brahman. So there is another champion. So I am working right now. He says also to teacher, don't worry, teacher. I am right now working on this Brahma Anubhava. And so this kind of a thing actually shows a lack of understanding. And then, teacher has to again show that this consciousness is Brahman, you know. And so, if consciousness is ever experienced, Brahman is also ever experienced. So, iti tadrushi uktihi keval lajjayai bhavati. Keval lajjayai bhavati means it is just a shame to say that I have to experience consciousness or I am waiting for the experiencing of Brahman, etc. And so, some of the points... We have to remember this consciousness is Brahman. We have to just remember. And 4 points we have discussed so many times, right? That I, the consciousness, is distinct from, is not a part, product or property of the body. First point. I have narrated also yesterday perhaps. The second, and that I am independent. I am consciousness which is independent. And enlivens the body, pervades the body and enlivens the body. And independent you can write as a third point. Or I am the consciousness which is pervading the body and enlivens the body. And the third thing is I am being independent. Well, the boundaries of the body, etc., do not limit me, right? Or boundary of body does not limit me, whatever. Therefore, this is the third point. Fourth point is definitely, and that is I survive even after the fall of the body because I am not connected to the body. I am independent, not part, not product, not property. But if property, product or part means of anything, means that thing dies, this also dies. Property dies when a substance dies. Then product dies when the cause dies. And what is the third thing? Part, product and property. So part. Part dies when the whole dies. Whole country is destroyed, Swamiji. And then one state remains. Cannot be. If you say whole country destroyed, then definitely, like body is destroyed. And then everything is destroyed here. Whatever the parts are there, also it gets destroyed. And therefore, basically, if I'm not part, product, etc. of the body, then if the body dies, falls, I do not die. So I survive the death of the body. That's another thing. And that I, the consciousness, survives the death of the body. And therefore, definitely I, the consciousness, is Brahman. How can you say? You are saying consciousness. Now lastly, after telling 4 points, you are immediately adding that Brahman into consciousness. If you are independent, and if you are not limited by the limits of the body, then what you are? You tell me. You are consciousness, not limited by the body means what? You are limitless consciousness. That is Brahman. And you don't have to use word Brahman all the time. You are limitless. That's the most important thing. That's a reality. Because of the false superimposition of the body, etc., you are feeling limited, which is mithya actually. Which is a notional. That is how you feel that you are an individual. Individual means a limited entity. Even though you are a conscious being, but you are a limited entity. And so once you ascertain the 3 points, then where is the question that you have any kind of limitation? You are a conscious being and with no limitations. Means what? You are limitless. And therefore, limitless consciousness, that is Brahman. In fact, the meaning of the word Brahman is limitless. Therefore, I need not have to use all the time word Brahman, Brahman, Brahman. You are limitless consciousness. You realize it. And for that matter, you have to realize you are not part of the body, not product of the body, not property of the body. That itself is sufficient. And yet you enlivens the body, shrotrasya shrotram, manaso manaha, vachoha vacham, pranasya pranaha, because of which everything, even the body is right now, has ascendancy. Body is basically alive, and all the things are functioning because the consciousness is present. Shrotrasya shrotram, you are the very ear of the ear, you are the speech of the speech. Because of you, the speech is there. Because of you, the status of ear, eyes, etc. are there to see, to hear everything. They are basically all jadam, and they are functioning right now as a conscious entity, experiencing form, experiencing sound. And how can a jada thing can experience anything? Cannot experience anything. Therefore, consciousness is present there. But then how can the consciousness be there in the jadam? Well, then it is a borrowed consciousness. Therefore, I am the one who enlivens everything. I am the one who pervades everything. That everything means here in the body. Outside also you can say, but right now we are doing a discrimination between body and Atma. Anyway, so this is the way. So you are limitless consciousness. And so I am Brahman, that is the fact. So it is not just enough to say that the consciousness is distinct from body. Well, you have to also understand that you are Brahman. Distinct from body, etc. Distinct from panchakoshas. Right now, that is under discussion. So, but suppose one person asked this question, that what should I claim? You are saying like that. That is okay. But I feel like claiming body as myself. So, out of these two, consciousness and body, if I claim body, what will happen? That body as myself. If I claim like that, what will happen? Then you cannot deny that you are not conscious, right? Well, then you will have to say, I am body with consciousness. And what consciousness? Which has been revealed as a Brahman. So you will say you have a consciousness which is Brahman. You have a limitless consciousness if you say. What does it mean? Please tell me. You are body, I understood. You are body and you have limitless consciousness. What is it? That limitless includes body or not? Please tell me. Then rather than that, you have limitless consciousness. Rather than that, say that you are limitless consciousness. Limitless should include you. Means your body. Then better claim that you are limitless consciousness. Okay? And therefore, between consciousness and body, I want to claim I am body. Yeah, another thing also is there. What? If you are body, body is not conscious of consciousness. Understand? You are consciousness and you have a body consciousness. So you are body means you are jada. If you are jada, then how can you say, to claim I am a body, you should be a conscious entity. And therefore, I cannot be equated with the body. Okay? And therefore, third thing. There are several points. Third thing also is there. If you are a body, that is your nature. That is your sarupa. Sarupa cannot go away at any moment. It cannot leave. But body leaves you. It is there just one. It is there in a one third of your life. It's just a one third of your life. Claiming body as yourself, it is just in a waking state. Claiming this body is just no. But I am subtle body. Okay. Included, that's a one more state. If you are really fan of that, include, and that too even in a dream also. It is not the entire subtle body. It's just a part of mind. Not even intellect is involved there. And therefore, definitely, and we both, even if you give up the claim, disidentified with both, you exist independent of it. Now tell me, are you body or are you consciousness? Tell me. Anyway, so I am Brahman, okay? So I am Brahman, all four features belongs to Brahman, and that is me. So, this is the way we have to understand. Let's go to verse number 21.
यस्मिन् यस्मिन् अस्ति लोके बोधस्तत्तदुपेक्षणे यद्बोधमात्रं तद्ब्रह्म इत्येवं दीब्रह्मनिष् यद्बोधमात्रं तद्ब्रह्मेति एवं दीब्रह्मनिश्चयः.
सो कॉन्शियसनेस इज एवर एक्सपीरियंस, इट्स आई मीन इट्स अ फैक्ट, वेर एज अदर ऑब्जेक्ट्स आर नॉट एवर एक्सपीरियंस, दैट इज ऑल्सो अ फैक्ट. They are experienced at one time, other time they are not experienced. You may remember or not, that is a different thing. But you don't experience any object all the time. All the time. Even if you are with somebody, all the time, whole day. But then when you sleep, definitely the experience of the other object goes away. So definitely no object will be experienced all the time. There is subject will be ever experienced, being subject, it will be always there. So experience of other objects is subject to arrival and departure, which is dependent upon a fact, what that an object experience takes place when there is a relevant thought, naturally, in the mind. When thought arises, object is experienced. When thought goes away, object is not experienced. Like we know, part experience we call part knowledge, and computer experience, computer knowledge, whatever. In all that, definitely the objects keep on varying. So Vidyarana says in every experience of object, actually there are two things. You are experiencing two things, but you count one thing. Of course, we saw this in Kenopanishad and here also we saw, but Vidyarana repeats here in order to strengthen this idea in our mind. So generally we say that in pot experience, basically I experience pot. Pot is object of experience. Experience by relevant thought. If thought will not be there, that object will not be experienced. So it is dependent on the thought. And that is one thing. In a pot experience, there is two things are there. One thing is the experience of pot itself. And second is experience of consciousness also will be there. So I experience, pot, meaning I am conscious of the pot, means not only pot is evident, consciousness is also evident, and this consciousness is evident not because of pot thought. Yeah, because the pot thought is there, therefore, consciousness is experienced. No, if consciousness is experienced because of pot thought, if pot thought goes away, you won't experience consciousness, but you are there to say that now there is no pot thought. So definitely, consciousness is experienced independently. It is revealing itself and therefore it is experienced independently. So when pot thought disappears, I continue to be a conscious being. That means consciousness is experienced self-evidently. So in every experience there are two things. One is an object, experienced because of the thought. And other is an experience of consciousness, not dependent on the thought. So what is not dependent on thought is independent. What is independent what is independently experienced, that is what we call as a self-evident, self-illuminating. So part is revealed, right? Part is experienced through the thought. So dependent on the thought. Therefore, in part we will not say as a self-evident thing. Its evidence is based on thought. Of course, the consciousness that is there, but we are just analyzing, we are differentiating two things. Well, even thought cannot illumine. Thought cannot reveal pot. You know very well. It's a jadam. Thought is nothing but a mind, right? Antakkaram, which is made up of subtle elements, which is jadam. And therefore, pot cannot illumine or reveal thought cannot reveal the pot. So thought is again associated with the consciousness. We call chidabhas, etc. So without consciousness, nothing is revealed. And anyway, so in any experience of an object, object is experienced because of the thought. But definitely consciousness is there, experienced, even when no thought is there. Even when no thought is there. In fact, you are there to say, right now there is no thought. Or this thought has gone and some other thought has come, whatever. So basically in absence of a particular thought, pot thought, etc., while consciousness is experienced. And therefore, we call experience of consciousness as all the time there, or experience of Brahman is all the time there. That is self-evident Brahman is all the time there. So then, well, so from part thought or part experience, then mind goes to some other object, and then relevant thought, tree thought, etc. will be there. So tree experience takes place. There also two things are there. One is a tree, dependent upon tree thought. Tree experience depend upon the tree thought, and consciousness is experienced self-evidently. So this is the second factor. Unchanging, non-dependent on thought, experienced by all, at all the time. All the time it is experienced. So when I start my class, you know, my words basically enter in your mind through ears. And so each word is experienced. I mean heard. Experience we hear heard. Each word is heard. Relevant thought also should be there. Otherwise, then you will have to ask, you know, who is sitting in next? You have to ask, hey, what did Swamiji say? Because thought was not generated. Word has come here. But the thought did not generate. Then definitely that is not experience. So any word is experienced by you, then relevant thought should be there. But basically consciousness also will be there, which is continuously experienced by you. It's an unchanging factor. And so any experience of object, well, remove object, left behind is consciousness, which is ever experienced, ever evident, and that is Brahman. That consciousness is Brahman, we have already seen. So why are you waiting for experiencing of Brahman? Why do you want to go to Samadhi, etc. for experiencing Brahman? You are right now experiencing yourself. Appreciate it as a Brahman. Appreciate it as a Brahman. To appreciate it as Brahman, you have to undergo a Shravanmana Nididhyasana. It is not easy. Let me tell you, it is not easy. Even though self-evident and self, it's not self-experience. It's all Svatasiddha, Svatasiddha. Moksha is right here. It's everything fine. But the moment we come out of the class, we know. Other than Brahman, we appreciate everything. We don't appreciate Brahman at all. Because of which you experience everything, because of which you appreciate everything, that thing only you forget. This is what the Maya is. Because this is Maya. This is a product of Maya, and Maya has done that job. Not just creating name and form, but it has been created in such a way that it will hide what is the reality. To make name and form is a real, and what is really the reality, well, that is really been hidden. That's how it is. Like Agnanam does the same job. You see, when you sleep, so basically you are a waker. Now waker is under the spell of ignorance. Now then the dream is created. That's dream is created, it's okay. If you are able to appreciate dream is, well, while experiencing dream, if you are able to appreciate it is mithya. There is no fun, I tell you. There is no fun. But what does ignorance, you know, what it does? Well, it covers the waker, that's a reality, and it creates the dream world and the dreamer, which is actually mithya thing. Out of ignorance it is created, right? Whatever is created out of ignorance is mithya, is projection. So it is created, that's one thing, but it gives a reality also. That is real. Waker is totally gone. Vekar is really the adhishthanam. Vekar is the substratum. In fact, the consciousness whole borrowed, existence is borrowed from that, for the dream world. In dream world, a dreamer is a conscious being, and there are other conscious beings, and there is an insentient world also, everything. But during dream, you feel only dream is a reality. Otherwise, why should you get frightened seeing the tiger in dream? Why should you? If you know it is a mithya tiger, in a dream, if while experiencing tiger, if you know it is a mithya, well, why you will go, you know, and to embrace the tiger, basically. You won't. You run for your life. So this is a job. Creating a name and form, one thing, that's one job. And giving a reality to that. And therefore, you forget that you are Brahman, which is actually self-revealing, and that is totally covered. Anyway, so it is ever, consciousness is ever experienced, in all the experiences. So and that is what even we in chapter 1 also we have seen. And well, in Jagrat, Supna, Sushupti, all the states, this is all the time. Varieties of the objects are there, and those objects are experienced depending upon the varieties of the thoughts. But the consciousness which is present in all, because of which you are able to experience, even through the thought, that consciousness is ever experienced without thought also. If it requires a thought, we cannot call it self-revealing. What requires a thought for experience, it is definitely revealed through the thought. Therefore, it is not self-revealing. It is revealed. It is dependent on the thought, etc., for revelation. Depend on consciousness ultimately for revelation. But consciousness is ever evident, ever experienced in all the three states of experience. We saw that in Panchadashi chapter 1. I remind you those verses. Verse number 3, 4, 5. Shabdas parshadayo vedyaha vaichitra jagare prathak tato vibhakta tatsambite aikarupyatna vidyate. So, shabdas parshadayo vedyaha. Vedyaha. Well, all objective, which are basically objectifiable, which are knowable. Shabda sparsha adi, shabda sparsha rupa rasa gandha, etc. All varieties of objects are there. Vaichitryat, they are varied, many and varied. Jagare, so in the jagrat avastha, in the waking state. Prithak prithak, they are all there. Tato vibhakta, and tat samvit. Samvit means this consciousness which is distinct from all this. So we have seen that, you know, objects are many. Then thoughts relate pertaining to the objects are many, and therefore perceptions are many. But in the consciousness, which is present in all the perception, is one. Aikarupyat nabidyate, that consciousness. And then it says in verse number 4, from the experience of the dream, from experience of waking, it goes to dream. Tatha sapne atra vedyam tunasthiram jagare sthiram. Tad bedaha atastayoho samvit ekarupa na vidyate. So it talks about sapna avastha, and then it talks about sushupti avastha also. There also the vrittis are there, thoughts are there. If you remember, I have told you the sukshma vrittis are there because it belongs to karana shariram. So what belongs to karana shariram, well, that vritti will be very subtle, means you will not be able to appreciate it. Right now you are able to appreciate the thought, your thoughts. So we call it as a sthula vritti. But during sleep you are not able to appreciate, even though there is a thought. But how can you say there is a thought? That's how I'm saying you are not able to appreciate. But definitely, because you have an experience. You have an experience in a dream, in a deep sleep also. Experience of happiness, experience of blankness. So definitely when you get up, you say that I experienced this. Well, so definitely if your experience is there, thought is there. I told you. Well, you say I experienced pot, then definitely pot thought must be there. And therefore, in deep sleep, Vidyaranya discussed like that. Nowhere I find that in a deep sleep state there is a vritti. No acharya has told like this. But if experience is there and you are able to narrate when you get up, then definitely a vritti must be there. Maybe a sukshma vritti, because karana shariram is there. Sukshma vritti and sthula vritti, the difference is one is not able to appreciate when it arises. Other sthula vritti means you are able to appreciate when it arises. That's the thing. That's how you are able to appreciate. Even if anger arises in you, you are able to appreciate, which will not be the case in the deep sleep state. Anything pertaining to karana shariram, you are not able to appreciate. Anything which is unmanifest, you are not able to appreciate. Yeah, we have discussed unmanifest butter in a curd, right? You are not able to appreciate. You tell your son or daughter that you go and get the butter to make pav bhaji, etc. But so it is right there. Right there. You can get plenty of butter if you just churn it. Curd is there. Not able to appreciate. You say curd. I mean, you say there is no butter in right now in my refrigerator. It is right there. That's how it is. So sukshma vritti pertaining to karana shariram we call avyaktam, you are not able to appreciate. And therefore, during deep sleep state, you are not able to appreciate the vritti. That's called ajnana vritti, sukha vritti, etc. We have seen that saushupta tamobodha bhavet tada smriti, etc. That verse also we have seen in the first chapter, the fifth verse. So loke bodha asti, anyway, in world experience takes place with respect to what? Yasmin asmin means asmin vishay. It's a vishay saptami. Vishay, whenever vishay saptami is there, you have to translate like this. Pertaining to that, with regards to that, in subject matter of that, in case of that, etc. etc. So yasmin vishay, regarding what? Regarding this object, various objects. Yasmin asmin vishaye. Well, so definitely experience has to take place, and well, definitely thought also must be there. So generally we think it is one unit, but you know, two things are there in every experience. And as we discussed, we have seen even in the case of, you know, one example we took to appreciate every experience, you feel it is a one unit. Well, experience of part means it is a, well, there is one thing only, and that is an experience of an object. But well, consciousness is ever experience also in all the experiences that you are not able to appreciate. And I gave you the example of that you are experiencing a hand right now. So while you are experiencing hand, you feel that you are only experiencing hand. No, you are also experiencing light. In fact, experience of light, because of light only you are experiencing hand, but that you are not able to appreciate. So more important actually is a light. Somebody asked that what is more important, light or hand? Naturally light. Light is more important. Because of light only you experience hand. Same way in experience of object, well, you miss the experience of consciousness. Actually, that is the important thing. Otherwise, where is experience? Where is experience? Where is experience without consciousness? But you don't count it at all. When you say, I experience pot, then definitely you count only pot. You don't count the consciousness, which is because of which only you experience pot. So, gata jnanam means what? Gatam plus chaitanyam. Gata vritti actually, but you take here pot. I should say pot thought plus consciousness, but I am just taking pot plus consciousness. So experience of pot means what? Experience of pot plus experience of consciousness. So anywhere that jnanam is consciousness. Gata jnanam, pata jnanam, we say like that. Or gata bodha, pata bodha. That word bodha has come in the Kenopanishad. Prati bodha viditam matam, prati bodham. Prati bodham means bodham, bodham, prati. In every bodha, in every cognition, ultimately cognition of anything, I mean pot cognition and any cognitions, camera cognition, light cognition, that cognition, tree cognition. In any cognition, basically the responsible factor, most important factor is the consciousness which is present in every cognition. And therefore without experiencing that consciousness, how are you going to experience the any other thing? So in order to focus, well, in our example, in order to focus on that, experiencing light, well, definitely, what should you do? So if I say, like you are experiencing what? You say, I am experiencing hand. Now I will say, well, you are also experiencing light. Okay. And then you go ahead. I say, don't go ahead. Focus on the light. That is in fact, that's the most important. Because of that only you are experiencing hand. Then you are asking me a question. How do you focus on light now? My focus all the time goes on the head. You say you focus on the light because of which you are seeing a hand, etc. Well, so what should you do for that? To focus on light, which is more important. So, well, we say when you see, you experience both the things. Then focus on light means basically, I ask you the question that what is that because of which hand is visible? Then, well, your at that time your attention goes to the light, right? your attention goes to the light. Well, seeing light is one thing, and focusing on light is another thing. So basically, same way, when I say you are experiencing pot and this, etc., etc., I am asking what is the responsible factor because of which you are able to experience. Then your attention goes to the consciousness. So that is how focusing or highlighting the principle is the consciousness. And for that matter, well, definitely you should basically do upeksha. He says here, upekshane. So tattad upekshane, ignoring that particular object which I experience. So you ignore the object which you experience, and you take into account the factor because of which you experience the object. That's how it is. That is the focus. So tattad upekshane, paying attention. Like sometime, I give you another example. When you go to a cinema hall, etc., when you to see a movie, temporarily, because you have bought $200 ticket, I don't know what is there. I whatever it comes to my mind, I say, whatever, $50 ticket or $200 ticket, and then you go naturally to see the characters. You are not interested in screen. But I tell you, all the characters are, they are there because of one thing. If that is not there, you won't see any character. So a responsible factor because of which even the characters are, we are able to see the characters, that is the screen. When I say that, so your focus goes to the screen. And so definitely, this is how it is, temporary, for a few seconds. I know you like the characters, but basically, temporary your attention goes to the very substratum on which all the characters are superimposed. And same way, here also, Vedanta tells that you should pay an attention to already experienced consciousness in form of I. So I am that consciousness. So tattat upekshane. So when you ignore tattat, every object, you are experiencing all the time in varieties of the, in the, all the three states of experience. You are experiencing varieties of the objects. Now ignore time being and pay attention to a factor because of which you are experiencing all the objects, and that is consciousness. So that is how your attention is drawn, basically. So yet bodhamatram, there is one consciousness, not that when you experience a pot and when you have, somebody said, well, Swamiji, you said pot consciousness and thought and the handkerchief consciousness and pen consciousness and paper consciousness. Maybe the just as objects keep changing, consciousness also keep on changing. No, sir. What is the proof, Swami? What is the proof you have that is only one consciousness is there in all that? Because you are connecting. I am not connecting. You say, I experienced pot before. Same I is experiencing, say, now handkerchief. So, well, I continue to be the same. So, I, the one who has experienced the pot, is now experiencing pen, is now experiencing paper. So that I, which consciousness, is one in all. So that is how, if you remember in the chapter 1 of Panchadashi, he very beautifully says, Aikarupyat na bhidyate. Ekarupa. It is present in all the varieties of the experiencing. As a one entity, it is not that it tato sam vibhakta sambit. So well, you feel that is a part consciousness, thought consciousness, etc. But consciousness is one which is present in all the experience and which is self-revealing. So, and if you remember, he has very poetically said, masabda yuga kalpeshu gata gammeshu anekadha. Well, naudeti nastameti eka sambit esha swayam prabha. So masabda, every minute it is same, every hour it is same, masabda yuga kalpeshu, every day, every week, every month, every year, every srishti, it is remains same. Na udeti nastameti, it does not rise, it does not fall. Thought arises, thought falls. Perception arises, perception falls. Object also comes and goes. Everything possible, but this consciousness, which is ever there. It does not arise, it does not fall. Eka samvit, then one consciousness present in all. And what is that? Swayam Prabha, self-illuminating consciousness, that is I. So Bodhamatram, that pure consciousness, segregated from thought and object or perception, Tad Brahma, that consciousness alone is Brahman. If you include body in consciousness, you are Jivatma. If you include mind in consciousness, Jivatma. If you include thought, you are Jivatma. If you include object, you are Jivatma. If you don't include anything, you say you are pure consciousness, you are Brahman. So that is how. So if you exclude everything, you are Paramatma. If you include all this, you are Jivatma. Then why should not I include? But I said, why should you include? Which is mithya. Why should you include? You should not include. But I should include because they are there. But what is mithya should not be counted. Anything mithya should not be counted. If anything which is real, you should take into account. Which is mithya should not be counted. If you still count, well, you are a clay. But then how will I separate? Yes, separation is not possible. What is mithya can never be separated. What is mithya can never be separated. Anything which can be separated physically is independent for existence. Like right now, if these two are independently existing, I cannot say, well, this is mithya and this is, and therefore clip is non-separate from the pen. I cannot say that. Both independently exist. And therefore, well, so don't think about, I want to be Paramatma. And you said, well, you include body and everything, you are Jivatma. And so I want to separate them. You cannot separate. What you cannot separate is mithya. Okay? So non-separate. It is non-separate. Why it is non-separate? Because it borrows existence. What borrows existence has to be dependent for that. It will be always non-separate. Like pot and clay. Anyway, so these questions will be always there. So it is not a physical separation because consciousness is Brahman. Actually, it is all pervading also. Well, nothing can be away from consciousness. We should understand this very well. Nothing can be outside consciousness. Try to think of anything. Try to think. I am telling you today, please try. Try to think of anything outside consciousness. Try. Even imagine object within consciousness, sir. Because that person, a great imaginer, he is the one who is doing a great imagination. All beautiful imagination. But he is conscious being. It will always be in consciousness. Always. That's how we say everything. Everything is non-separate from consciousness. Nothing can be outside consciousness. Nothing can be inside consciousness. Inside consciousness and outside consciousness is with respect to space. The very space is consciousness. And therefore, anyway, everything is non-separate. That's how it is mithya. So it will be there. It will be there always. Don't try to separate them. Learn their mithya, they drop off from you. So, vyavarik sharir etc. is ever non-separate. So, and therefore they cannot affect me also. Therefore, I am limitless. They cannot bring their limitations to me. They shine, they are limited, let them be limited. I will enjoy. Once you know you are Brahman and they are mithya, they cannot do any harm to you. They cannot bring any limitation to you. They cannot impose their attributes on you. Good or bad, whatever. Then basically you enjoy limited body. Yeah. You are not able to enjoy the body because it is not the limited body. Limited body, it is all right. But it is limited me. And that you cannot stand. So limited mind you will be able to enjoy, it is other than you. I mean it is non-separate from you. It is mithya. Then you will be able to enjoy. But basically you are not able to enjoy because limited mind is not limited mind, it is limited me. Then you cannot stand. That mind becomes it's a horrible. You cannot stand it. People, you have to take tablets or you will have to take drugs. I mean you know this, not you. Person has to take drugs because he can't stand his mind. Because he and mind are not two entities. He is mind. When he is mind means limitations of mind is basically limitations of the person. And you cannot stand. It is very genuine. Why? Because you are basically limitless. So you can't stand limitation. This is superimposed. Anyway, so just as a vyavaric screen is, you know, is very distinct from this Pratibhasika movie, etc. So let the movie continue. Same, let all the vyavara body, everything continue. Well, oh, you don't know this. Okay, I don't know this. Oh, your body has so many these problems. Yeah, my body has so many problems. Earlier, when I was ignorant, well, body's limitations is my limitation. So I can't stand. If somebody points out some defect, some limitation of the body, mind, senses, I just can't stand. Immediately I oppose. Whether it comes in my mind or whether somebody tells you, you can't stand. Now you are able to stand. Okay. It's a limited body, limited mind with, and I enjoy all this. I enjoy all, these are the sadhana for me. So just as you enjoy this Pratibhasik movie, imagined movie, you know, I imagine one person asked me in Chicago that he is a youngster. He said, Swami, what do you want to prove? I was literally taken aback. Even satsang he asked me. I said, I am proving this mithyatva. Then he said, what are you going to get by proving mithyatva? I said, when you go to cinema hall, what are you going to get? Tell me. What are you going to get? Tell me. Well, he said, I enjoy. I said, when? When do you enjoy? Knowing that whatever is happening in that movie is reality, that way you enjoy? Or knowing everything is mithya, you enjoy? He said, knowing mithya, I enjoy. That's all. That's what I am doing. Proving everything mithya. So in order to enjoy, once you know it is mithya, you enjoy. You cannot enjoy the world knowing it as a real. It's a big headache. You have all the complaints, in fact, for the world. Not a single one. I have not found a single person who does not complain about world. Anything you come in contact with, you have a complaint. Anything. Even the best partner in your life, you will have a complaint. Which you have chosen, not your parents. Which you have chosen, parents were saying, don't go for this person. No, he is Sarvaguna Sampanna. He is Sarvaguna Sampanna. I find all positive things. Swamiji, I find all positive. Okay, go for me. Within a year he comes back, or she comes back, whatever. Not a single person, not a single object. Even in a food items, well, you say this is good. I tell you, one day you say that this is not good also, Swamiji. I read about it, this is not good. Everything in the world is basically having guna and dosha. It has guna virtues from one standpoint and it has vices from another standpoint. And therefore, if such a world, which is embodiment of this, if you think it is a real, and forget about the world, your own body, you have so many complaints. So many complaints about your mind. My God. In fact, the maximum complaint you have is about your mind. You may have a complaint about others' mind also, but your mind also, you have a big list. So knowing the world as real, that's how people want to shun themselves from the world. They want to close themselves. I don't want to meet anybody. Knowing mithya, you can enjoy. In fact, before entering the cinema hall, he knows that whatever he is going to see, whatever they are going to cast, everything is mithya. Still you pay $300, $400, whatever, $200 for seeing them. Then that person agreed, of course. Yes. So, but his question was very good. That knowing mithya, what do you want to prove ultimately? We want to enjoy our life, knowing mithya. So with limited mind, you can enjoy. Limited me, I cannot enjoy. So if I take mind as myself, I cannot enjoy. If I take mind as a mind, which is going to be limited, which is by nature it is limited, and it will remain limited also. I can enjoy. Limited body I can enjoy. Everything I can enjoy. So I am mukta. That's how it is. So, I'm sorry. It's time is up. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.